Hello, investors, and welcome once again to our session here today. This is Think Scripting, and my name's Ken Rowe. Some of you will remember that last week we talked about the average true range and how to put that information on a chart. Well, I had several questions and comments in relationship to that. One of the ones that came up frequently was, how does this average true range relate to Keltner channels? And how can we use these types of things to identify possibly overbought and oversold situations? So that'll be one of the primary focuses of our discussion here today. We also did a drill down last week. I got a lot of positive comments about, hey, is that something that we can do on a more regular basis? Well, because today's sessions is on Friday at the end of the week, I'm open to that. So we'll do another drill down here today. But if some of you kind of thinking, I don't know if we want to do the drill down every time, do feel free to send me a message to that as well, because we always want to tailor these sessions to what you would like to see and what you find to be the most beneficial. But before we get too far along, let's go ahead and pop through our disclosures here. And just remind investors that the information here is for general informational purposes only. It should not be considered an individualized recommendation or endorsement of any particular security, chart pattern, or investment strategy. We do use a paper money software application here. This is for educational purposes only. We want to remember that successful virtual trading during one time period does not guarantee successful investing of actual funds during a later time period, as market conditions do change continuously. Also, for the sake of simplicity, the examples in this presentation do not take into consideration commissions and other transaction fees as well. Also, keep in mind that backtesting results presented are hypothetical. There is no guarantee that the same strategy implemented today would produce similar results in the future. And of course, past performance of any security or strategy does not guarantee future results or success. But typically in here, the process we usually use is we identify a goal. And we ask ourselves the question, can thinkscripting meet the goal? You know, there's a lot of things you can do with thinkscripting, but thinkscripting, unfortunately, we're not able to do everything. Or there's quite a bit that we can do. When we identify the goal, we ask ourselves realistically, hey, can thinkscripting be helpful in here, helpful in these situations? And usually it can be helpful. Then we'll outline the steps of scripts, we'll apply the thinkscript tools, we'll write custom scripts when needed, and we'll test what is written related to the goal. Now, we've actually done all these steps in relationship to an average true range script that we presented last week. I didn't do it, actually. This was provided to us from our good friend Robert Boucheret, and we were able to take a look at that and see how that could possibly be used. We also shared the link related to that. Those of you that were not here last time, that link is available to you in the description of the YouTube video. So if you look over there at the YouTube window and go down to the bottom, you'll see a short description. When you click on more, you'll get a more detailed description. When you open up that more detailed description, you'll see in there a link for the ATR customized script in there. So that is available to you there. Let's just go ahead and jump right in then to our discussion here. We'll talk about, do a little bit of a review of the discussion we had last week. Then we'll take a look and we'll compare what average true range is in relationship to a study that's available to all of us. And that is going to be the Keltner channel. Let me go ahead and pull up the thinkorswim platform here then. And we'll just jump right in here. And we'll look to have a little bit of extra time at the end here where we can do an end of the week drill down right here. But let's go over here and pull up a chart here that we can use. So here's a chart. I'm okay using SLB Schlollenberger. And you can see here on the chart, we have these two labels down here. One is a green label and it's giving us 0.5 ATRs. The other one is a red label and it's giving us 0.5 ATRs. What that 0.5 ATR, what those 2.5 ATR numbers mean is that the horizontal line that goes out from that label, which is also included in the numeral right there, that's horizontal lines at 50-55, and this horizontal line is at 48-67. Those horizontal lines are going out one half of an average true range. In fact, let's just pull up at the average true range study here quickly. And just so those of you that may not have been here last year can kind of get an idea of what we're talking about, but you do want to feel free to go look at, I think I said last year, I meant last week. Those of you that were not here last week, you could go out and catch last week's session as well. Let's just get a study up here so we can see it. Okay, so this is our average true range. And again, in quick review, the average true range is just the average range that the stock tends to trade in over the previous 14 trading sessions. Range meaning from highs to low. The formula is also nice because it takes into consideration gaps. So we take half of that average true range. You can see right now here the current average true range is at $1.25. So if we take half of that average true range and we add it to the existing price, then we get our top number. If we subtract from our existing price, we get our bottom number right here. Now, do you need to pull it up here on the chart? No, you don't. You can just grab this number down here and you can do the math and add that number to the existing price, subtract it, and then use those numbers like that. But it is kind of nice to have it here on the chart, because by having it here on the chart, we can see it visually nicely. We also kind of see where it's at in relationship to our technical analysis and what some potential price points may be in relationship to that. Now, a great some of the really good sessions that you can use related to the average true range. I would say that a lot of the coaches use average true ranges here and there, but also Barb Armstrong, if you look up her session, she does a fair amount of using average true range as far as targets with regards to entries and also as far as targets with regards to exits. So if you want a little bit more information as far as using it from a paper trading perspective, I'd encourage you to maybe check out some of Barb's sessions that she has available here as part of the coaching realm here on the Trader Talks network. Also, you know, I was talking a little bit earlier about that YouTube window and how you can go in and find the links, for example, the links to build the average true range here and other links along those lines. While we're talking about that, don't forget, if you look in the lower right-hand corner of that YouTube window, you'll see a subscribe button. You always want to remember to subscribe if you haven't already subscribed. That just helps you to keep up to the latest and the greatest that we provide here through the Trader Talks channel. Okay, but that's basically the average true range we're looking at here. Now, those of you that may not have caught it last week, let me just show you a couple of quick adjustments that we made to this, because this is not part of the link. In fact, you could call this homework. What I'll probably try to do is to update those links sometime between now and the next session. But when you download the link that's available to you on YouTube, you may want to come in and make this little adjustment. And that is, I'm going to come up here to study right here, click on studies and choose edit study. And I'm okay going through this a second time as well, because I did have a fair amount of questions. Say, Ken, can you show us again what you did to change the color that was used on the chart, and also what was done so that the average true range could come up in portions rather than as whole numbers? In other words, so we could do half an ATR or one and a half ATRs rather than just one ATR, two ATR, or three ATRs. So here you can see I've gone to studies, I've gone to edit studies, and right here is our average true range study right here. You can bring it up the same way. Then just click on our little scroll right here, open that scroll up, and we won't read through all this because we basically reviewed this last time. Again, I'd refer you to last week's session, but a couple of key lines here. And one of those lines is, let me see if I can find the actual line number that we can use in relationship to that. Yeah, so the key line here is line number 35. So when you open this up, you can come down here to line 35 right here. Okay, and on this line, we have a color, and it's just right here. When you pull it up, your line will look just like this, but when you get here and it says else, it'll have color, and then it will identify color. You may want to replace that statement with this one, this guy right here, where you have color, and then I believe the default is color.yellow, something like that. You may want to replace it with get color, and then open parentheses, and then for, and then close parentheses. By doing that, if you're using a light background, it will give you a different color that's much easier to read than if you just go with the color.yellow. So again, that's line 35, and you might want to change this little guy right, and you might want to change what is there with this. Now, if you open it up and it says get color 4, don't worry about it, okay? Because there is a slight possibility they may have sent out an up-to-date link, but I don't think that I did, okay? But that is one little simple adjustment that you can make in there. And the reason that would possibly be a suggestion is if you look at this label right here, this label, I believe, is blue if the current day's range is greater than the average true range, and it's yellow if the current day's range is less than the average true range. Well, this is kind of our orangey. So just kind of look at that and say, yeah, that's closer to yellow than it is to blue. Well, that's basically what that's telling us. This is telling us that Today's range is 0.66 and the average true range is 0.63. Okay, so that's when I'm looking at that, that's telling us that when this is the orange or whatever, that means that the average true range is, it looks like that's going to be less than what when today's range is less than what the average true range is. Look at that. It looks like it does here, it takes a look at half of the average true range and looking at that in relationship to that. So just a little bit of a heads up there and a little bit of an update there on the average true range. Well, another question that came out was, okay, Ken, I'm seeing the average true range. I'm seeing this, but this kind of reminds me of another study that is available on thinkorswim called Keltner Channels. You know, if we have Keltner channels, do we really need the average true range? And do we need to show it on the chart if we can show our Keltner channels on the chart? Well, I'll let all of you make that decision here. But let's go ahead and pull up Keltner channels. And to do that, I'm going to go ahead and collapse our left-hand side right here. So that's collapse. And let's go ahead and take off all these drawings right here. I'm going to just clear our drawing set. Got a nice clean chart going on. Right now we have two moving average lines. What have I got here? I've got a 10 period moving average, that's in green. And it looks like I got a 20 period moving average, that's in black. Just to make things a little bit cleaner, I'm gonna turn off the 20 period. Well, do we want to maybe, you know, perhaps I want to use the 20 period moving average. Yeah, let's do that. Let's go ahead and use I'm kind of hip on around here a little bit. Hey, but let's go ahead and use the 10 period moving average as far as looking at Keltner channels, okay? So to do that, then I'm going to come up here to studies on the thinkorswim platform and click on studies and choose edit studies. I want to turn off my 50. So I got simple moving average here, which is 20. Actually, what I want to do is I want to turn off the 20 here, okay? So I'm going to come up here, click on the gear right here, and right up here, I'm going to put a check mark here where it says show study. I'm going to take that off where it says show plot. I'm going to take that off as well where it says show bubble. I'm going to take that off. So that should clear that off of there. So now we're just looking at a 20 period moving average right here. It's interesting, isn't it, that when you look at the 20 period moving average, it's sitting right on that half ATR point. That half ATR point, again, is it's one half of an ATR above the current price. That's something to keep in mind because when you're looking at Keltner channels, and when you're looking at just average true range, the thing to keep in mind is the average true range is just adding that average range that the stock trades in from highs to lows to the current price. You can add it to get to the upside. You can subtract it to get to the downside in relationship to that. The Keltner channels are different because what the Keltner channels does, it does use average true range, but it's different because the Keltner channels, they take that average true range and they add it to an existing moving average and they subtract it from an existing moving average. In some ways, the Keltner channel is somewhat similar to Bollinger Bands. It's not the exact same thing, but it does have some similarities, okay? And if we come over here, I'm just gonna come up here and grab a study right here and choose edit study. And then over here, we have our studies in the box up here. I'm just gonna type in Keltner. And that's our Keltner channel right there. I'm going to go ahead and highlight it. Then we'll choose add selected. And now we've got our Keltner channel on here. I'm going to open this up because I want to tie the Keltner channel to the 20 period moving average right here. To do that, I'm going to click on our gear right here. And that's the length. That's where I want it. Now, right here, I have our average true range set at a half. Why don't I go ahead and set the Keltner channel here as far as the factor we want to use there for the average true range. I'm going to go ahead and set this to a half as well, just so we're kind of looking at an apple. Well, you know what? Let's do this. I'm going to move this out to, I just like to be able to see some separation here. So I'm actually going to move this out to a 2 on the 20 period moving average. And then on my ATR label here, I'm going to move this out to a 2. I think this will help it to be a little bit cleaner to see. Okay, so they're both set at 2. Let's go ahead and click on apply here. And there you have it right there. Okay, so we can kind of see the difference going on here with regards to these. And it's interesting because I've got this 20. This is the moving average that's currently being used. The reason I say it's interesting is I thought I selected a 20-period moving average, but these are different. I'm wondering if one of these is an exponential and the other one is a simple. Let's come back over here and choose Edit Studies. Come back here on our Keltner channel right here and open that up. So we've got average type simple, average true range simple. The average true range, this is going to be our averages right here with regards to the true range. We have two averages going here. This is going off the price of the close. And upper band, let's just check out our colors here. Upper band's right there. Lower band matches up right there, and the average is green. Yeah, that's interesting. So we got 20 right there. And then how about our simple move? So we have a simple moving average 20 here, and we have a 20-period moving average here. But those are not lining up, and I would believe that they would. Was it the 10? You know what? We stayed with the 10, didn't we? Yeah, we stayed with the 10. So let's do this. Let's go ahead. Yeah, I've got this one. Yep. I should have remembered that. You guys are probably over there chatting saying, hey, Ken, wait a minute. We went with the 10. Well, let's turn the 20 back on since we have everything else set up at the 20. Then they should pull those in line with each other. There we go. Now we just have one nice wide moving average line there. Okay. So, you know, sometimes investors are looking to identify whether or not a stock is overbought or oversold. And that's one of the functions that the Keltner channel uses, or that's one of the functions the Keltner channel can be used for. Because if an underlying security gets out of that Keltner channel, we're talking about two average, true range, that's an indication when you hit that upper channel, the underlying security could be overbought. And when the underlying security falls down below the lower Keltner channel set at two average, true ranges, then that's an indication the underlying security could be oversold. And we can see here on our chart, here's our upper Keltner channel. We came up here, we touched the upper channel, indicating potentially being overbought. Then we reversed down. We came down and we touched the lower channel. We didn't quite touch it, but we came close, indicating perhaps we're oversold. Then we went up. Then we came up and we're kind of banging up against the Keltner channel here, indicating a period of being overbought. Then we move back down here. So you can see there's kind of this reversion to the mean, reverting to the mean line right in here. But as we go down, you can see it doesn't do a perfect job. I mean, we came down here and we fell out of here, but we did eventually bounce and head up in here. Now, sometimes it's beneficial to look at the moving average line itself. If the moving average line itself is moving down, then frequently the lower Keltner channel will represent a potential support level, and the moving average line itself will be a resistance level. If we're moving sideways, then we get into more of a situation where the Keltner channel is providing support down here at an oversold area and providing resistance up here at an overbought area, and we tend to move between the two, okay? But that's basically, investors, the primary difference between the two when we're looking at the difference between what is the average true range and what is the Keltner channel. Keltner channels can be used to identify overbought, oversold. Individual securities can be a little bit different. So you do want to feel free on a Keltner channel to go back in time and kind of fine tune it so we can see what's happened historically when an underlying security has moved outside of those Keltner channels. And then we don't know that that will happen in the future, but it's better to go off something than to go off nothing, right? And then with regards to just using the ATRs, a lot of times this is going to be more of a spot situation where we're looking at possibly entering in a security and we're managing our reward to risk. And perhaps we want to set it up so our risk to the upside is at two ATRs and our risk to the downside is maybe 1.5 ATR, just so that if the trade's successful, we're making more than we had at risk on the original trade. Of course, we always want to keep in mind that there's probabilities to keep in mind in relationship to that. If you make things too strict in relationship to that, then you're usually going to end up with a lot of losing trades in relationship to one winning trade. For example, if you set it up so that you're trying to get three ATRs before you get stopped out at a quarter of an ATR, well, you may get there, and when you get there, that's going to be a terrific reward to risk. But you may have quite a few getting stopped out at those quarter ATRs before you actually have a successful trade and move all the way up to the higher ATR. Okay. All right. So investors, that's a little review of what we talked about last week, as well as addressing a question. I did have two or three questions in relationship to this, just because there is that relationship between Keltner channels and the average true range. Okay. Well, another comment that has come up recently, and this could be as a result, you know, as we're kind of bringing things together between the TD Ameritrade side and the Schwab side, we're bringing things together and bringing applications together. We fare to have more of a diverse audience here in our sessions. That does bring up some questions that are a little bit different than what we've had in the past, but that's okay. These are all very good questions. I think they're beneficial to everyone. But I have had some questions and some requests that said, hey, can we just see how we can do contingent orders on the thinkorswim platform using scripts? In other words, perhaps make a contingent order that's a little bit more complicated. Now, this question usually is derived from the fact that on the thinkorswim platform, we can put together strategies that are basically backtesting systems. You can pull it up and it will go back in time and say, okay, this was an entry, this was an exit, this was an entry, this was an exit, and goes back in time. So the question inevitably becomes, hey, can't we just set that in the system and have it trigger actual live orders? Well, we're not actually able to do that with ThinkScript, okay, as far as having a system that takes us in, takes us out, takes us in, takes us out, takes it, so on and so on and so forth. You can't set up an order that will automatically, theoretically, take you in at a point and then theoretically take you out at a point, but then that's usually it. You know, you're out of the trade and then you would need to go back in and reset things. That type of systematic type of a situation, that may be something that could be coming down the line, but we don't currently have that yet. But as far as triggering orders from a contingent standpoint, since I have had quite a few requests on that, I'd like to just go through maybe one or two samples of looking at something like that, okay? And to do that, you know, we usually like to find a stock that maybe has a trigger that would sometimes be considered. Right now, I'm going to take our ATR study off of here, and I'm going to take our Keltner channel off of here, just so we can look at things purely from a technical analysis standpoint, okay? Let me sit up here just a little bit and come up here to our studies and edit studies. While those studies are coming up, I do want to take a peek over here in the chat window and welcome everybody. And Ron brings up a great question. Why Keltner over Bollinger Bands? You know, I'm more than happy to address that as well. But I want to welcome Ron and Wiley, and looks like we have Jody, Kathy, Kevin, Nirmal, and Eddie, and Dragon Rider, Tom, and Robert, and everybody else. We have Mike Fairborn here with us in chat. Always great to have Mike here with us. Very knowledgeable investor. Do feel free to send your questions over there to Mike as well. So why don't I address that question before we jump into here, because I don't think we're going to be awfully strapped for time. But the question is, Why use Keltner channels over Bollinger Bands? Well, I would say that that's not necessarily what you want to do, okay? You may want to use Bollinger Bands. I think the key thing is to keep in mind the nature of the calculation between the two. And maybe I can grab a little drawing tool here for just a second and just show you this. So basically, when we're talking about Keltner channels, we basically have talked about Keltner channels, right? It's taking a moving average line. You pick the moving average line that's coming out as many ATRs as you want. In this case, we're going out. We're going up two ATRs and down two ATRs. The Bollinger Bands is a little bit more, I think you may pay, perhaps the right word is sophisticated. The Bollinger Bands looks at the normal distribution of prices. Perhaps many of you have seen this, okay? And these would all be price points like this, okay, like that. So you've got you have the lion's share of your prices around this mean right here. Then when you get out here, you have fewer and fewer and fewer and fewer prices. So that's the normal distribution of prices. So you're talking about Bollinger Bands. Take that normal distribution, just kind of set it on its side. So you're looking at something like this, okay. And so as you get to the outside of the bands here on the Bollinger Bands, you're getting out here into this rather rare area where price goes. So Bollinger Bands is more of a statistical measurement using the normal distribution of price action. And I would say try out ATR, try out the Bollinger Bands, determine which one you feel the most comfortable with, and then go with it. And you may want to switch. And the nice thing about having a paper trading account is you can switch back and forth between the two. It may be beneficial here just to throw the Bollinger Bands up here to see how they go in relationship to what we're seeing here with regards to the average true range. I do have two ATRs here, and I believe the default setting for the Bollinger Bands is to go out two standard deviations, and there may be a relationship there. Let's just throw them up here quickly. Edit studies and Bollinger Bands right here. We'll bring those over. We're going out two standard deviations. Let's get our lines on our Bollinger Bands. We got the lower band here. I'm going to make the Bollinger Bands really fat so we can kind of tell the difference between the two. The upper band, going to make that really fat as well. You should see some similarity, but maybe not a whole lot. Yeah, you know, there's a fair amount of similarity. So you can see how the Bollinger Bands work. You know, one of the nice things about the Bollinger Bands is we have this Bollinger squeeze that indicates that we're coming up on a time where we could squeeze and bounce out. So that's something you could possibly use these together. You could use the ATR to identify, are we overbought or oversold? Then you can look for squeezes to indicate a potential blowout to the upside or the downside. So perhaps there could be some benefit in that as well. All right, let's go ahead and take these guys off of here for now then. We'll take them all off here. Just so we can look at setting up a contingent order on the thinkorswim platform. I didn't go through a lot of stocks, but I found one or two that represented maybe some possibilities here. And I want to bring my moving averages back over here. So let's come over here and let's turn our 20 back on. Oh, looks the 20 is on. We want to turn our 10 back on. Put that 10 back on there. There we go. And there we have right there. Okay, so frequently, investors will want to possibly enter a trade based on the underlying price of the security crossing above a moving average line or crossing below a moving average line. And to kind of give you an idea of what is typically used if we're looking at crossing above a moving average line, a lot of times you'll see an individual security that has been moving to the downside like this, okay? Moving to the downside like that. And as part of that movement to the downside, you'll have a couple of moving average lines. Maybe I can get a couple of colors here. A couple of moving average lines is going like that, a slower one, and then possibly a faster one that's hugging the price a little bit tighter, you know, like that. And you're looking for that fast moving average line to break above the slower one. If and when it breaks above that slower moving average, that could be a potential entry signal. Well, we don't know. You know, if we break above that moving average line, how far of a break do we want to have above that moving average line? This is where the think scripting could possibly come into play. We can go ahead and put in a moving average crossover here, but we could add to that through the use of think scripting by saying we not only want to break above that, but we want to break above it by a certain amount. And then we could leave that in the system. And theoretically, when those conditions are met, then our order would be triggered. Okay. So let's take a look at an example here of a contingent order using our thinkScript. I'm going to go ahead and use MRO because it has moved down here. See, we came up here, we almost crossed. We actually came up here, but we did cross here. Maybe not as much as we would have liked to. Like not only cross above, maybe get a little bit, maybe exceed that cross and go a little bit higher. Possibly we could use an average true range in determining that. It looks like right here, our crossover, it looks like currently our average true range is 0.62. Maybe when we get across here, we not only want to cross, we want to cross by two ATRs and leave the system in there to see when, if that gets filled, something we can leave in there so we don't have to actually be there when the cross occurs. So I'm just going to do it here, investors, right from our chart here. I'm going to do a right click here and we'll choose buy like so. That brings up an order here. And then I can come in here and I can click on edit. And this is where I can come in here and work with my order. Now, those of you that are new to the thinkorswim platform. Another way to bring up a trade order, you just come up here to the trade page like so, and come over here to where it says ask price right here and click on the ask price. That'll also bring up the same order. Okay, so now we have our order here to buy 100 shares of MRO, but we want to have this to be a conditional order, a conditional order that is contingent on the 10 period moving average crossing above the 20 period moving average, and when that cross occurs, to have the price to have that moving average. I think, do we want to have the moving average or do we want to have the price? Let's take a look back here. So when we get that cross there, we want the price to be a certain ATR above that 10 period moving average. This may get a little complicated, but that's okay. We'll give it a whirl here, okay? All right, so I'm going to come over here then. Here we are on thinkorswim. We've got this going on here. I'm going to click over here, click on our gear right here, and bring it in. By the way, investors, these sessions are being archived, so do keep that in mind. So this is our order. I'm going to change our order type here to a market order because I don't know where the price is going to be when this all occurs. I'm going to make a good till cancel, market order, good till cancel. I'm going to come down here under our conditions. Okay, there's our conditions. I'm going to click under symbol. I'm going to tab over. When I tab over this method right here, this is where we can go in and set conditional situations with regards to an order. I'm going to click on mark here, and I'm going to come down here and choose study. And under study, I'm going to come down here and choose edit. Okay, so there's our edit. And this is the box where we perform the magic, or at least attempt to perform the magic. All right, let's make it a little bit bigger so we can see it okay. I'm going to come up here. First thing, I'm going to delete what's ever here. Gone. I'm going to add a condition. I'm going to click on add condition. When the add condition box comes up here, I can start over here on the left-hand side and choose study. Okay. And I want to choose simple moving average, S-I-M-P-L-E. There it is. And I want this to be my 10 period moving average. So here's my length on my moving average. So I put that at 10. And we'll come down over here. And I don't need to see any breakout signals. I just 10 period moving average. And I want it to cross above study. I'm going to choose simple, S-I-M-P-L-E. Simple moving average. I want to set this one at 20. 20 right there, show breakout signals. Now, this one here, I'm going to use this functionality here, investor. It says within how many bars. But remember, we're asking for a couple things to occur here. We're asking for the 10 period moving average to cross above the 20, but then we're going to attempt. I don't know if this is going to work out. We'll try it, okay. But then we're also going to attempt to say, we also want the price to be one half of an ATR above that 10 period moving average. Let's try it. Okay. So now, because when the cross occurs, the price may not be one ATR above that 10 period moving average, I'm going to say I want that to occur within three bars. So theoretically, this cross could have occurred 3 days ago. It may occur today because, you know, when you think about it, to pull that 10 period moving average above that 20 period moving average, it's going to take some strong price movement. So yeah, I'm thinking about the strong price movement it's going to take to bring that thing above there. I don't think I need to go to within. Let's go ahead and leave within off of here. I'm thinking we don't need it, but we do want to have our length here set at 20. Okay, so there's the 10 crosses above the 20. Okay, I'm going to go ahead and bring this down here and let's click on save. Up to this point, investors, we haven't used any thinkscripting at all, have we? We've just used the tools that are available to us, okay? But we want to do a little bit more here. So to do that, I'm going to come up here to kind of click on ThinkScript Editor. And let's give ourselves some more room here so that we have an editing space. So there's our condition. That's condition one. I'm going to put this condition in parentheses to separate it from another condition we're going to do. Like so. Okay, there's condition one. Then I'm going to say, and I want the close. Now in thinkscripting and in the language of thinkscripting, close is the same thing as current price. Okay, just keep that in mind. When you're doing things with thinkscripting, close is the same thing as the current price. Okay. So I'm saying close, which means the current price I want that to be. And I can either type in the words greater than, or I can just put in the symbol greater than. So I've got greater than, okay. And I'm going to take, here's my 10 period simple moving average. I'm going to go ahead and copy this so I don't need to write it in again. I'm just going to copy that right out of there. Do a control C to copy it, and I'm going to pop it right here. Okay, so there we are, guys. Now we're saying the close is greater than the simple moving average 10. Okay, do we want to get tricky, okay, and add some type of an average true range to this? Well, let's see what we can do here. So I'm going to take close is greater than this average. I'm going to put this in parentheses, okay, like so. And then I'm going to say plus. ATR plus how much of an ATR am I going to do here? Let's see. Did we get plus? Let me try that again. ATR right there. Do I need to do one of these guys? Yep, that's it. Now, sometimes investors, when you bring up a study, you just need to put the open bracket and the close bracket in order for the system to realize, okay, this is a study. He just wants to look at one ATR. Okay, so plus the ATR. Well, I don't want to do a whole ATR, right? We're saying about 50% of an ATR. So I'm going to do plus ATR times 0.50. Okay, and that's it. That's all squared away now. So we're looking for a cross above the 20 period moving average. And when that occurs, we're looking for the closing price to be above the 10 period moving average. We're looking for the 10 to cross the 20 and the price to be at least one half of an ATR above that 10 period moving average. Now, one of the reasons I have that in there is to avoid this, and it may not avoid it completely, but sometimes you'll see stocks when you're looking at those two moving averages, they're basically going like this sideways, okay? And they're crossing each other and so on and so forth. By saying that I want the price to be at least 50% of an ATR, that puts us more in a situation where we may be looking at something that's kind of been in a downtrend like this. It's taken a lot of price movement to move it up to cross above that. Here, usually don't have as much price movement. Of course, in thinking about it even further, if we're running flat like this, that ATR is going to be relatively low, so it may not function that way either. As you get into this, you can see that things pop up after things pop up after things pop up. But I feel like this could do a fairly decent job. But what we'll do is we'll follow up on it to see how it goes. Okay, so we all squared away up there. I'm going to come down here and length must be positive. Okay, where's my length? Probably is it in here? ATR. Length equals 14. Oh, it says length must be positive within. Oh, I got that within there. That's giving me the problem. Within one bar, is that it? Yeah, that was it. I still had that within there, even though I set it to zero because I'm not using it. I do have to have at least number. Now, if I didn't put anything in within, then we wouldn't have had that issue. So let's go ahead with that, investors. We'll go ahead and click on okay, and by the way, trigger if at or below, we want to set that to trigger if true, okay? So we put our script in here. We're saying trigger if true. That'll trigger our market order, so we'll go ahead and say okay here. This gives us a little synopsis of our order. We'll go ahead and click here, right there, like so. And we know we haven't crossed it yet, right? So if this order gets triggered, then there's something else going on. Let's do a confirm and send. And we always want to read the details here. Hey, this is a study-based order. Carry special risk? Absolutely. With stop orders, there's no guarantee the execution price will equal at or near above. So we want to keep in mind, we don't really have an activation price here. That's why we left it as a market order, but we're not sure exactly where this will get filled because of those things. So always remember to read this and read your red. Click on send, and there it is. It's ready to go. So we'll go ahead and follow up on it. Well, Messrs., looks like we got about 4 or 5 minutes here. So let's go ahead and do the drill down. And again, if you're thinking, oh, Ken, I don't want to look at the drill down, then contact in the bottom of the YouTube window where it says comments. But hey, can we pass on the whole drill down? Or if you like the drill down because it is Friday, it's the end of the week, then I'm more than happy to continue to do it on Fridays here. But here we have the S&P 500. We can see the trend, okay? Moving up here, we do have two red candles. What we really want to do is drill down to find areas of strength or weakness. So we're looking at here today, because it's Friday, is we're looking at the week, not the day. The day, it's energy, okay? But it's Friday, so we're looking at the week, so we're looking at percent change. And this percent change is set to 4. The reason it's set to 4 is because the way thinkorswim platform works is it starts at the current day, then it counts back 4, which is actually going to be the previous 5 trading days, okay? I may look at that further and fine-tune it, but let's go ahead and go with 4 here today. So this is telling us that if I sort by this guy, we know energy is the strongest here today, but for the week, it's communication services. So strongest sector is communication services. They are the 50s right there, the 50s, okay? We got that done. Let's come over here and look at the strongest industry group in the 50s to find that out. So we're going to come down here, and what is the strongest industry group? Here we are in our 50s. So come down here. Here's our weekly numbers. What is the strongest weekly number right there? I'm coming down here. And I've got, let me make sure I got my percentage set here right. Do I have that at 4? Which would match, yeah, I got it at 4, so we should be good on that. Okay. So for the week then, I got a 118, I got 146. And these are all 50s. So it looks like integrated telecommunications. Okay, so it's integrated telecommunications then. Let's remember that integrated telecommunications, and let's come up here and say communication services is 50. This is what's creating a question for me. We may not have time to finish this here today, investors, but those percentages are a little bit surprising. Because see, this is the entire sector. Is communication services, which is 50. I come down here, this is the 50s, all these ones that start with 50, and communication services right here is sitting at 5.96%. I come down over here and I look at my 50s, where is something as strong or stronger than 5.96%? And investors, I'm not seeing anything. Occasionally, we get a glitch in here, okay? And this is one of those times because we've got everything set up here. What I'll do is I'll check out that glitch and we'll discuss the glitch, whatever it was, next time. But yeah, this is not. We should be able to find an industry group that's stronger than the overall sector because the sector is an average of all the different industry groups right there, and that is 50, and that is, let me double check that. Yep, that's 50 right there. Okay, that's all right. We'll go ahead and we will revisit it next time. Let's go ahead and wrap things up here for today, though, okay? Oh. So, investors, what did we do here today? Well, we revisited our ATR. We related that to Keltner Channels. Then we wanted to put an example in ThinkScript on the thinkorswim platform. We may do 2 or 3 more of those just because there's a lot of different ways to use it. And I have had several requests in relationship to that. Hey, just a reminder, you can follow me on X, formerly Twitter. My handle over there is @KenRoseCS. Love to see you over there. I'd also encourage you to follow Mike on X as well. He posts a lot of great information over there. Also, circle your calendars for Monday. Oh, probably not this Monday, but the next Monday. For covered calls and cash secured puts. Mike teaches an excellent session on those each and every Monday. All right. Everybody, thanks again for joining us here today for ThinkScripting. I hope you have a fantastic rest of your day and a wonderful week. Best of success in your investing, and hope to see you back here again next time. Bye, everybody. We'll see you.